We begin tonight at 11 o'clock with a look at major reforms promised by the Baltimore City Police Department trying to prevent police brutality.
It's an issue that's gotten a lot of attention because of a beating caught on video near the Lexington Market, but also what's been going out near Ferguson, Missouri.
Yeah, we have team coverage on this story tonight. ABC 2 News' Christian Schaefer has a look at what the police department plans to do right now. Christian?
Jamie and Kelly, step one was the release of this report called Preventing Harm, Conduct in the Community. Tonight, an attorney from the ACLU of Maryland says promises and reports are nice, but following through on those promises is what matters.
The mayor and the commissioner say part of what led to the 41-page document, conversations with people at town hall meetings across the city.
The commissioner and I talked to more than 2,000 city residents. They were clear that they wanted to see more action taken to address excessive force and police misconduct complaints.
The release of this video of a beating earlier this year also seemed to bring new urgency to the issue.
But anger without action never leads to change.
Among the recommendations in the report, more officers in the Internal Affairs Unit, more power for the commissioner to discipline officers, and better training for officers.
We outlined some of our dynamic training, including constitutional impartial policing, emotional intelligence, and de-escalation techniques.
Tonight, the senior staff attorney for the ACLU of Maryland tells ABC 2 News the organization will be watching to see whether the reforms are implemented.
What matters more is not words on a piece of paper and good intentions. What matters is the ability to reform the culture of the department.
And he says without pressure from city residents, whose tax money funds the police department and the lawsuits that stem from police brutality, reform simply won't happen.
The degree to which this will be a priority for the police commissioner and the mayor, I think, depends on the degree to which it's a priority for the people of Baltimore.
Now, the ACLU will continue to monitor systemic issues within the police department. They don't handle individual lawsuits, though, from people who say they've been victims of police brutality. ABC 2 News' Catherine Hawley continues our team coverage with some of their reactions to what the commissioner and the mayor promised today.
Well, Christian, since Batts became commissioner 2 years ago, the number of officers disciplined internally has increased from 57% to 89%. Still, the victims of police brutality in the city say more needs to be done.
They have beaten faces, battered bodies, and broken bones. Baltimore City Police say complaints against officers are going down, but a recent string of excessive force cases is eroding the public's trust in the agency. It's videos like this of a city officer violently beating up a man at a bus stop that now has the department taking a look at how it handles police brutality.
Unfortunately, the video was the straw which has kind of broken this thing open.
Tony Garcia represents Colin Truss, the man you see police punching in the face repeatedly. Garcia tells us he has mixed feelings on the department's sweeping plans.
Is what the citizens of Baltimore want is accountability. They don't need a new program, a fancy slogan. They want accountability.
He thinks too often other officers stand by and don't step in, saying the culture within BPD needs to be addressed.
Those officers can't come out and speak about the things that they see because there is an internal pressure, an internal culture, which prevents them from speaking out against the other officers.
Other families who claim to be victimized by police feel the reforms are a step in the right direction. Tyrone West died while in police custody last July. His loved ones say they want to see action.
They really want to do a reform. First of all, it starts with honesty and being transparent with families. I'm highly upset because nobody never was transparent to my family at all.
Now, the report does call for an overhaul of training used for the force, a creation of an early warning system for bad cops, and a way to publish more information about use of force incidents. Catherine Hawley, ABC 2 News.
Following a string of high-profile police brutality cases, the City Police Department could be under the microscope of the Department of Justice, following a letter asking for full review by the Attorney General. WJZ's live, Rochelle Ritchie with more on the letter and the mayor's reaction. Rochelle.
Well, Vic, this is the letter sent to the Department of Justice by the president of the Baltimore City Council asking for a full review of the Baltimore City Police Department's policy, procedures, and practices. In a letter to the Attorney General Eric Holder, Baltimore City Council President Bernard Jack Young says the number of cases involving allegations of excessive force by Baltimore City police officers is disturbing, and he wants a full review, a probe the mayor supports.
While some electeds are acting surprised about this issue, it's something that has been in black and white and has been an issue for decades. I'm just the one who's willing to do the hard work to correct the problem.
Incidents alleging police brutality caught on camera just this year, one officer is seen punching a man repeatedly at a bus stop, and in another incident, officers used batons and tasers on a man outside of a popular lounge, both men now suing. The issue of police brutality in Baltimore City, a historical problem.
Stay down, stay down, stay down.
According to our media partners, the Baltimore Sun, in just the last 3 years, the city has paid nearly $6 million in cases of false imprisonment, false arrest, and assault. Many of the officers still on duty today, such as the officers seen here outside of Melba's.
They were never suspended. They were never disciplined. They were just taken off to asked to take a couple days off and catch their breaths before they went back out and to duty.
The Sun's investigation also highlights one officer on the force since 1993 that has cost taxpayers more than $600,000 in cases of police misconduct. The mayor says getting rid of those few bad apples in the department is key.
That's why with Commissioner Batts, we disbanded that unit, the VSIS unit that was responsible for an excessive number of those complaints.
The Department of Justice has not confirmed if they will investigate, but the police commissioner says their doors are open.
They'll go back and look at our issues dealing, if there's issues there dealing with supervision.
And our media partners at the Baltimore Sun also found that the city has had more than 300 lawsuits involving civil rights and constitutional violations. I'm live tonight, Rochelle Ritchie, WJZ Eyewitness News.
Rochelle, thank you. And new legislation is being considered to equip officers with body cams to hold officers accountable.
Mayor Stephanie Rawlings-Blake and the police commissioner Anthony Batts released a plan now to reduce police brutality. Karen Parks tells us about the policy being blamed for escalating tensions between the residents and the police officers.
We didn't create these problems.
More allegations of police brutality after these videos surfaced last month. One shows officers using batons and tasers to arrest a suspect outside of a Baltimore City nightclub. Another shows an officer beating a man at a North Avenue bus stop. But officers involved in both incidents are still working for the department and still getting paid. A situation police commissioner Anthony Batts says is part of the problem.
It could have been my sons on that bus stop the night of that event where excessive force was used. It's unacceptable. It will not be tolerated within this organization.
Today, the department released a plan they say will address a broken disciplinary system.
This isn't fluff. This isn't child's play.
We're reforming the internal discipline process so that bad actors within the Baltimore City Police Department are punished to the fullest extent possible.
The city's report also says Batts wants to develop an early warning system for brutal cops, overhaul training in the use of force, and get better recording equipment for officers who investigate wrongdoing within the agency.
I can announce today that my administration is already in the final stages regarding the body camera recommendations.
Since 2011, the city has paid more than $5.7 million in settlements or jury verdicts.
We have not been in alignment with our community. We are moving in that direction.
The report also says while crime has decreased, a policy called zero tolerance led to a high number of arrests for minor offenses and ignited tension between the citizens and police.
We need to push the envelope, post haste, and move the envelope into a way that we can better and repair relationships with our community and police.
Karen Parks, Fox 45.
Meantime, there will be several town hall forums next year on this very matter.
The now infamous video of a city police officer beating a suspect earlier this year at a bus stop was again the focus of the mayor and the police commissioner as they presented a report card on their efforts to reform the city police department and restore the public's trust.
It could have been my sons on that bus stop the night of that event where excessive force was used. It's unacceptable. It will not be tolerated within this organization.
The mayor and commissioner say their plan to deal with officer misconduct is having some impact. The number of officers who've been disciplined internally has nearly doubled in the past 2 years. Plains Clothes units, popular under previous Commissioner Fred Bielfeld, but a magnet for citizen complaints, have been disbanded. But what Batts wants is power he doesn't have now. So the officer in the bus stop incident is still employed by the department and is suspended with pay. Batts previously worked on the West Coast.
I have fired people within 15 to 30 days if they were found guilty with egregious acts along those lines.
But you can't do that here, am I correct?
The law does not allow.
New legislation would be needed to weaken the protections police officers have. Meantime, the mayor wants reform in the police union contract. She also said today the city is moving closer to putting body cameras on cops.
I can announce today that my administration is already in the final stages regarding the body camera recommendation.
The report issued today by the mayor and the police commissioner takes a swipe at the policing practices under Martin O'Malley's tenure as mayor in Baltimore. The report says those zero tolerance and mass arrest policies from the years 2000 through 2005, 6, and 7, they created a rift in communities that still exists today. Reporting live tonight from City Hall, I'm Jane Miller, WBAL TV 11 News.
Now to tonight's cover story. Questions about just how far police should go when enforcing the law.
First, a ruling from a federal judge about the protests in Ferguson, Missouri. The judge ruled Ferguson police violated the Constitution when they told protesters that they had to keep walking and couldn't stand still. In some cases, officers told protesters they couldn't stand still for more than 5 seconds. In others, they were told they were walking too slowly. The judge issued a preliminary injunction forbidding law enforcement from carrying out the practice. Law enforcement agencies adopted the policy on August 18th, a few days after protests began over the shooting of Michael Brown. Well, a confrontation between police and motorists in Indiana in September has been captured on tape.
The cell phone video now takes center stage in a lawsuit filed against the Hammond Police Force. Mike Tobin shows us exactly what happened and why police pulled over the family in the first place.
I got shot in my back with a taser. He started just tasing me, and I just started going. It just felt like my body was finna shut down. And then he tased me on the ground. I'm asking, like, please just stop tasing me.
A lawsuit has been filed against the Hammond Police Department in Indiana, alleging excessive force, what the victims describe as a brutal act, all caught on tape. According to the complaint, police pulled over Lisa Mahone for not wearing a seatbelt. In the car were her two children and her boyfriend Jamal, all en route to the hospital when the incident occurred. Officers ordered Mahone's boyfriend Jamal, who was sitting in the passenger seat, to get out of the vehicle. During that time, you can hear Mahone on the phone with 911, saying she fears for her life after police drew their weapons on the couple.
What was the purpose of a gun? And now they asking me to open my door so I could get out. I'm scared. If you can pull out a gun in front of two, it's two kids in the back seat.
The police department is defending the incident in a statement that reads in part, quote, "The Hammond police officers were at all times acting in the interest of officer safety and in accordance with Indiana law." But an attorney representing the victim says that's not the case. The family is not only seeking compensation for emotional distress, but a change in law enforcement.
The officers proceed to escalate this incident beyond what is any reasonable person or officer should do.
Turns out two of the officers named in the suit are no strangers to trouble. Both Patrick Vicari and Charles Turner have been named in other lawsuits alleging the use of excessive force. In Chicago, Mike Tobin, Fox News.